All right, folks, back on the Boss Man Show, friend of the show, brother in Christ, brother in general, from All Access Network, Uprise Athletics. He's got MTEs, he's coaching, he's at the gyms, he's broadcasting ESPN, he's doing everything. It's my man out there in Colorado, where it's probably cold as can be, Brian Burton. What's up, brother?
What's up, homie? I appreciate the intro. It's not too cold yet. It's, you know, the thing about Colorado that's interesting is the weather changes its mind all the time. So you never really know. The morning can feel like it's in the 40s. The next thing you know, middle of the day is 85, and then at night it's cool again. Then it may be 100. I think it was 100 2 days last week, or 3 days last week, or close to it. And then they actually canceled school. Get this. So the schools out here, a lot of them don't have AC. Wow. Imagine that. They don't have AC. So they literally canceled school, the high schools in one of the districts around here, because they didn't have AC and it was too hot. So, and then 2 days later, it was 50 degrees. So that's Colorado for you.
Wow. See, this morning in Atlanta, it's foggy in the 50s.
Right.
High today is 77, which is rare here this time of year.
Hey, that ain't too bad. That's some good weather right there.
But see, I love it hot and hotter. That's
that's how you roll.
Yeah, I like it hot as can be. Now, I don't want it devil hot, if you know what that. I don't want it devil hot or Satan hot, but I like it hot.
No doubt. I've experienced plenty of hot days from my Texas roots. But it gets hot here. It's a different kind of hot though. So this is the way I describe it. It's like the way you see back in the day, the science experiments when you had a magnifying glass and like you just keep staring at that one spot for a long period of time. And then all of a sudden you start seeing some smoke come up. That's what it feels like up here because of the elevation, but you can find shade and it's cool in the shade. It's not like in Texas, it's just hot period. It's like a fog is over you and you can't shake it. It don't matter if you're in the shade, in the sun, if you're in the groceries. And every place is freezing inside because it's so hot outside. So you got to almost have a jacket or a hoodie just in case, because it's freezing everywhere because everybody's trying to balance it out. Whereas here, if you're in the sun, you might get cooked. But if you're not, you might be all right. And the mornings and evenings are always, always dope.
I feel that, man. Yeah, like I call Texas like that dry but wet heat. Here is just wet heat. Here is just lemon pepper wet heat here in Atlanta. So it's a little bit different. Texas is kind of that dry rub heat. Like, oh, man. It's crazy out there, man. But how's life been, man? Are you and the family and the kids? How's life going for you, my brother?
Yeah, all is good, man. Transitioning one year into home. I think, yeah, my first episode with you, I was living in my in-laws' basement during the pandemic. So we have moved into our own home. I think second episode, I might have been in the home. So we've been a year in the home, which has been amazing blessing. We have my oldest is in kindergarten. My other two are also in their learning centers and all that good stuff. So just getting settled in. So it's been dope on that side. And then from a business side, I mean, you said something from the beginning. That part is just continuing to grow and be a blessing. And yeah, my wife she's happy with me because we're living in the same place.
Yeah.
We're not moving around and we're finally not in, we were in my in-laws' place for a year, almost and a half, year and 3 months. And then we were at my mom's and I was long distance. So 7 cities in our first 3 years of marriage. We're now one full year in our home, not in somebody else's here. So we're trending up right now. We're trending up.
You're moving on up through the east side.
We like Georgia Wheezy.
I feel that, man. Yeah, because I can only imagine. I know how it is on my end trying to just date somebody and you schedule I keep. So I can only imagine being married with children, how that even a bigger thing to try to navigate, tiptoe around. So I can only imagine that the wife is happy. Since we all know, happy wife, happy life.
We got a pretty good flow. It's definitely happy wife, happy life. She just landed from California, seeing her, who you interviewed, her twin sister, Nikki Cannon, the new head coach for volleyball at UC Riverside. She just went to their tournament this weekend and do the twin thing. You know, they had to do that. She took my oldest. And so during volleyball season, it's a lot of one-on-three. It's a lot of me in transition, like trying to hope I can make him shoot a jump shot. You know what I mean? Like bluff and recover, try to figure it all out. It's a lot of that because she's gone or she's doing her thing in season. Her volleyball team, she coaches at a high school here, along with she runs the upright side of volleyball. So they just beat the number one team in the state and the number five team in the state in opening weekend. So they got a chance to do some things. So that's fun. And, yeah, the dad role, we were kind of just talking about this before we started, man. That's the most – of all the titles, we have multiple businesses and all that fun stuff, and we're growing it, and that's exciting. But the father role and the husband role is the most important, you know. So for me, I grew up in a home that was phenomenal in love for us, but the love for each other was not. So it affected us in its own ways, and my parents are phenomenal. I say it to this day, but that was probably the hardest thing about my childhood was feeling like not knowing what that looked like inside my home, because there was always this tension and the arguments, and they end up getting divorced. So I think the way I look at fatherhood, the way I look at parenting is just super intentional, just to be different and make sure we can change some of those cycles. You know what I mean? And my parents, they get along great now. They're not together, but at that time it had its moments for sure.
Well, so man, you have similar backgrounds because, you know, my pops and my mom Dukes never were together. So I came into it on separate accord. So a relationship with mom Dukes, a relationship with pops. It's not a same relationship I have. It's two separate ones. And to this day, in their advanced age, they hate each other's guts. So, and you know it. And they live seven houses apart, brother. That's what's so funny about it.
How about that?
Seven about houses that? Apart. That's what's the crazy thing about it. So I say both advanced aged individuals and had that same callous intention for one. Like, y'all let it go. I'm almost 40 now, so can we let it go? Like, I love you both the same, but it's like, bro, at graduation, it was who am I gonna hug first? That was the big battle of graduation.
Tricky.
Senior day, who am I going to communicate with first?
Tricky.
You know how senior day is had both parents out there. You know, my hate was like that was awkward.
right.
Senior day was awkward, brother. I'll put it like that. Senior day.
We try to avoid all those awkward moments now. I definitely can relate.
Yeah. So, you know, like I said, thank you for sending my father, Pops, a video chat for his birthday. He enjoyed it. He loves you. He still calls you the all-access brother. That's what he calls you. The all-access brother. I like the all-access brother. That's what he calls you. The all-access brother. I like you.
Yeah, I appreciate it, Pops. The first time we talked, yeah, on the phone, you were hanging out with Pop. I think it might have been his birthday then. Yeah, it was.
It was.
First time we talked. So, yeah, I got nothing but love and respect for Pops as a fellow coach to coach. You know, we got that vibe anyway. So, much love and happy birthday again.
No doubt. My brother asked his man for you. How was it hosting the MTE last year? How fun was that?
Yeah, great question, man. I don't actually know if I've really been asked that question. It was a lot of fun. It was a lot of fun. It's kind of one of those things that I never saw myself doing, like a lot of things that's happening now in my world. I think, you know, when you're on the other side and you are in those events, it's like a lot of things. You have a perspective of what you wish could be a certain way at certain events, or you appreciate about this event. So I think the cool part was being on the other side and knowing how hard those jobs are that those guys have, and then just knowing my experiences and trying to do our best to put it together where everybody could have a great experience. So the best part about it probably too was that my wife actually told me afterwards, she's like, you know, you really did that. Like, there was no, like, I thought there was going to be something along the way that was going to be like, you know, maybe a bump in the road or like something that didn't go as smooth, but like, you really put that together. I'm like, first of all, I did a lot of it because basketball was more my lane, but it was pretty amazing. We had a great turnout. Great turn of events as far as like everything going smooth and great feedback from the coaches. And yeah, that's all you can really ask for, man. I don't know how many more times we'll do MTEs. We're kind of shifting a little bit more into the youth sports space. We did a 3-on-3 league this summer where we had 72 teams in 3 months. Over 800 games were played, which was incredible. And then we got to employ the local college guys and even some high school athletes to come and be referees, so it could be a community feel and vibe. So I love that. And then we have our very first high school preseason showcase that we're putting on October 1st. Just working to kind of, you know, we want to leave things better than what we found it. That's who we are. That's what we believe in with Uprise. And my wife and I kind of created this company where we're doing consulting, events, and development. And we want to be able to give back in as many ways we can through the games we love. So this particular event, from where I'm from in Texas and where you were at in Atlanta, these things happen all the time because people are trying to play and compete and coaches are recruiting. And in Colorado, there's basically team camps in the summer and they have some fall league, but there's no events where the state kind of gets together or parts of the state get together to compete and get ready for the season. And the thing about that's different in Texas, high school coaches can't coach their players at these events. Whereas in Colorado, you can actually coach your team. So you can show up as the coach with your team with no restrictions. So, yeah, we're going to do our best to put our best foot forward on that. We got some exciting stuff planned around that. And then, yeah, just keep building, man, and keep figuring out how to give back to the community and touch basketball and volleyball in as many ways as we can. We got the media side. We got this other side over here with Uprise. So we're just looking to keep growing and making some positive impacts and adding value to other people. That's what it's all about.
Now, have you got your daughters hitting the ball yet? Are they out there hitting the ball yet with your wife?
So there's like a little. I'm glad you're a smart man. You knew how to preface that because volleyball is the priority. I just let that be the thing, and whatever they gravitate to, they gravitate to. But they have been in some camps with mom this last off season, so that was cool. They got a chance to experience that. And then, of course, my oldest just went to that volleyball tournament at UC Riverside, so she's been able to see some up close. And then we went to see mom. I think I sent you the video. We're at, you know, I got one climbing on my back. I got one in my lap and one on my arm trying to climb on, watching volleyball games. It's definitely tricky with three in the stands, but yeah, they love sports, period. I think the cool part for me, basketball wise, I've never done anything with them other than like the little tight goal outside or in the basement. But I don't try to do a lot. I just try to let them have fun with it. And when they bring it to me, we do it. But they've been in the gym with me to see me, you know, train and teach and coach, which has been fun. But the funny thing now is they're in this little space with movies. There's different movies that kind of stick and they just want to keep watching them. And it has been a while that something stuck like that. Like Encanto was like that. Sing 2 was like that. Moana was like that for like a good year and a half. There's been some movies like that. Right now, it's Space Jam. Space Jam 1 and Space Jam 2. Every single day, they want to watch Space Jam. So, and I never even introduced it to them, I don't think. Maybe one day I may have put it on. And then ever since then, it's been a wrap. So, who knows what sport they play? I don't even necessarily care, but they're better athletes than I was already. I can tell you that from their mom. So that's a good thing.
So you're giving them a choice. I had no choice. See, B, I was
you put the pigskin in your hand.
3 years old, running routes with pops. I'm hitting with a Fisher Price bat, showing I was hitting left handed and right handed. Okay, I got a glove in my hand, fielding wiffle balls. Okay. And I'm shooting a ball on my Fisher Price 66-foot goal in my bedroom. I had no options.
No choices.
None. This is what you're doing.
Hey, it worked out well for you.
It did. Like, I remember sitting on his lap as a young dude, him having me draw plays with him. Hey, you playing Madden? Redraw the play for me that you see on Madden. That's what he had me do.
I think all my X and O knowledge for football definitely comes from Madden. All my knowledge about football comes from playing Madden. Whether it's defense, offense, all of it comes from that.
Yeah. So He still is day, brother. He has the yellow pad. He's yesterday. He told me he charted some plays watching the Falcons. I'm like, you did yeah. what? You charting plays? Like, so I'm gonna show you when I see you. I'm gonna show you day when I see you. Like, okay. So that's what this yeah, man still does.
Yeah, it doesn't leave. It doesn't leave. It's like Gatorade. It's in him.
Yeah, like, man, like, I just want to come over and chill and just relax. Review Get this, son. Look at this. Look at this. I said, yeah, Dad, that's inside zone. I know. I know that's power, a counter trap. I know all this, Dad. But he'll quiz me. He'll quiz me. I'll come up, he quizzing me.
I love it. Now, when you play, was he doing all that when you play? Was he after the game giving you the rundown?
Yeah, what he took notes of. Well, really, it was trash my quarterback, but still,
he should have threw you the ball.
Yeah, you was open on that dig round. I said, I know, I'm aware. I trust me. It's been made. I made a point to let that be known. I was in the zone open, and you threw it over there. It got it picked off. I know. Yes. Hey, he'll be in the stands, trashing my quarterback. Okay.
I got to steal one question for you. Recently, I read the article that they wrote on you here recently. I think it was last year.
Yeah. And
of course, you've been in media now for a long period of time. I'm a newbie in this media space, but obviously. You know, media is media, but being a black man in media or a black person in media has its own challenges. So what would you say some of the things you would celebrate about I read the article, which was great, in telling your story and the grind. People think it's easy. People get on the Boss Man Show or they see you on social or the internet and they think like, oh, I want to do that. And they might think it's easy. But what things are you probably most proud of in your journey for getting to where you are?
I hate to say this, brother.
I had to flip it on you for a minute. I had to flip it on you.
I hate to say it, but nobody helped me out. I did this on my own. Then I reached out to those who were in positions for help when I was a nobody. And now I see them at games and stuff. They want to come talk to me. And they like to say, I put this person on. Every connect I've made, I did on my own. Because I booked my own show still. I never let nobody book for me. If you get to see on this show, it came from me. Nobody got them, but I did that. So it's like having to try to break down and prove yourself to people all the time and still put out good content, even knowing that there are some limitations due to how schools operate, how teams operate for its access to their players and coaches.
Right.
Know I've accomplished all this, knowing there's still big old obstacles out there, because you can see I'm independently owned. I'm not backed by ESPN, Yahoo, Disney, Barstool Sports. I'm not backed by a mainstream conglomerate. It's just JR.
So
I have to fight for everything I get outside of my employer. You see what I'm saying? Any team I deal with, any cause I deal with, I have to fight for that. I had to fight to get in the Final Four with the NCAA people. They want to do it. I said, so nobody interviews as many coaches as I do. I know that on every week basis. Look at my work. Right. And knowing I'm putting out quality work, and then I said, well, he has a point there.
Right.
You know.
Oh, he's had it on. Look at his body of work. You can't argue with that.
You know, so, and this is with me getting shut down by the schools in their Power Five.
Right.
Because I'm going to show you an example. SEC in the Peach Bowl one time told me, well, we don't see that you have any coaches on your show. It wasn't because I didn't try. I had receipts. Right. Every school, either a no response or an excuse. So how can I have content and cover the school when I'm trying, they don't let me? Then they had to say, okay, we'll approve your credential now. Because it ain't my fault. I reach out to every school every year. And I have receipts.
Right.
You say Tom is all too busy, he's too busy. Okay. Coach K can't do this, he can't. Okay, cool. It's my record, I tried.
Right.
ACM trying to tell me you didn't try. I did.
What would you say to we'll take turns. I'll get one more and then I'll let you get the questions back. What would you say the why is to what makes you do what you do, the passion that you have? Obviously you work with the Hawks, but you also have your own show. What's the why to be in media for you?
It's what I'm born to do. If you know what my real life be, I'm very antisocial into myself, which some of you wouldn't believe.
Right. It's hard to believe.
But it's true. But when I get on the microphone, I open up, I can be engaging, entertaining, electrifying, you know, I can give you some knowledge to help,
right.
You know, and I'm good at this. I can impact people, lead people. I can give them, you know, some vitamin, help them mentally, physically, and spiritually, and emotionally. I'm very, what I would say, I have range. I can go from religion, politics, finance, credit repair, sports, entertainment, comedians. I can interview anybody from any background. I have range. Some people only have one thing they can do. I can only talk about hockey or soccer, or I can go from religion to comedy, to an influencer or Instagram model. If I want to do that, I can use me back today. You know, I have range, so I know I can impact people. I have a platform, I have a voice. That's why I do what I do. And plus, it pays the bills well, and I don't want to have a real job.
Yeah, hey, it's not a real job if you love what you do.
Yeah, so I don't want to punch up by a time clock. So this is good money and good thing to do, cover sports for a living, and also be able to talk to comedians, musicians, actors, you know, doctors even about certain things as well. So network I've built from this grassroots thing I did started 2012. It's amazing to know what I've accomplished. Still knowing there's things out there that bumps in the road that I can't overcome because of, it's not even my fault. It's just because people are stuck in their ways. If that makes sense. Yeah. They don't want to. If you ain't backed by a corporately backed entity, you're not important to them, which is unfortunate. But it's true though.
But you're still killing it. Still killing. All right, I got my couple questions in. I can get the mic back.
Yeah, you came in there and did that, brother. I see you.
Yeah, you had to, man. Had to. It's only right, man. We gotta have some fun with this thing, man. You know,
No doubt. So let me ask you, my brother. So for you, being in this media space, how are you enjoying it?
I love it. You know what I mean? I really do. I think again, the perspective, you have a different perspective because you play at a high level and you have an eye from that vantage point, and then you had a father who was a coach, so that's the basis of your perspective, right? So you appreciate coaches differently because your father's a coach, you grew up with a coach in your home, so your relation, the way you deal with coaches, and part of the reason why you have the guests you do, and part of the reason why you have the rapport you do, is because you're not a traditional media member that's looking to find all of the things that they're not doing right, at least your guests anyway. Now those that are not your guests, I can't speak for, but I think that it all is about our perspective, right? So my perspective, I play college athletics, but I also coach for almost 20 years. So there's so many things that when you've sat in that seat and you know that your livelihood is dependent on this, that you have a different approach. So the coolest part for me is not only doing the interview part and the podcasting and connecting with rising coaches and doing all the DEI stuff that we do, but it's also, I got to be at a broadcast last year. So that just kind of gave me a different kind of a voice to be able to speak live on games, to be able to represent. Again, you're influencing the minds of any viewer that's watching. You may be on a broadcast that has 10 viewers that day. You may be on one that's 10,000 that day. You don't know all the time, but I was at high enough levels. Two, whether it's a high level or low level, I know I get to take the time to put into my craft to learn about these teams and what they are trying to do and not just what I think they should do. There's a moment in time where I can offer that, but I think respecting the game is so important to me and being able to give a voice to the voiceless. There's a lot of people out there that are doing great things that are not going to be able to be on ESPN. So how can they get some press for what they're doing, right? Which is similar to what you do. So I think that part has been dope. And then being able to be an advocate for sometimes things that's right, talking to other media members, like, you know, having real conversations and giving them perspective. If they've never played, never coached, and they've just sat behind a computer screen or behind a pen, it's hard sometimes for them to relate. So being able to connect and give that other perspective has been powerful. And then, like I said, being on air where you can be at it. Like we had a game last year where a coach got kicked out 5 minutes into the game. And I think for me, I would want to represent that coach's program the best way we can, even though he's not coaching. You could easily just throw him under the bus. You know, I mean, you see people do that a lot. And I think there was a guy criticized last year. I won't get into any names. It was an NCAA tournament team. There was a team that almost upset a bigger team. And this coach was super critical of one of the coaches, the underdog coach that almost won this game against a number one seed. And the analyst was very critical. And a lot of people had things to say. And I think there's just an element of, like, we have our personal opinion and we have to do our best to kind of take that out of it when it comes to the job that they're doing, especially if they're outmatched or out, you know what I mean? So I think there's just a relatability, I guess I could say, that try to represent that, but then still speak truth. So if somebody's not getting something done, you can speak on that. But I think there's just a way that you can do it where it's not like, because now when you say that, everybody else thinking like, oh, well, he's not doing a good job. It's like, well, wait a minute. Is he not doing a good job? Or are they just, you know what I mean? Was it that play? Or are they exceeding expectations, but they just couldn't quite pull off this upset against a team they weren't supposed to beat anyway? So, but no, I love it. There's a long-winded answer, but I love every single aspect of it too, because you get to learn the stories and help tell the stories again that a lot of people aren't telling. I think that's my favorite part about it. I was at the low and mid-major, JUCO, D2, did the highest level too, but, you know, the highest level, everybody wants to cover them. Everybody wants to cover the NBA, the Atlanta Hawks. If you're in Atlanta, everybody wants to cover the LA Lakers. You know, what about, you know, Pepperdine? You know what I mean? What about the UC, Cal State Fullertons and the UC Riverside, who I've already spoken of, and the Texas A&M Commerces? So, yeah, I'm loving every minute of it. The cool part too, and you experience this even more than I do, but your guests that come on, like we had a ton of mid-major coaches on last year that are now all high-major coaches. So you see all these guys that before they made it, quote unquote, they
the
were at
key
a
lower level. They should remember who you are after they move up. That's the key. Because I have a few of them this year who moved up who I can't find no more.
Forgot.
I ain't going to say no names, but
a few
of them have forgotten your boy already.
but you already got receipts, though. You already got receipts.
Hey, I said, okay, I see how it's going to work for you, you know? Yeah.
And we keep notes, but it's still cool to be a part of that before they got to that place. You know what I mean? Whether you're
assistant,
become a head coach or whatever, you still got that experience. So I'm definitely loving it, and I appreciate your connection and help and perspective that you share continually. There's not a lot of us in this space, so I appreciate who you've been and what you've done for me.
No doubt. And I'll tell you something, like on the Atlanta Hawks side or the Falcons side I've been on, the Patriots side, you have to, when you're on their space, you have to kind of make it just about the game at hand. You can't give your opinion.
Right.
Now, in this space, I give my opinion. I love this space because I have written in my contracts with anybody I deal with, you can't tell me what I can say when I can't say on my show. That's between me and my show, not you. When I'm on your spaces, Falcons, Hawks, Braves, Pacers, Grizzlies, whoever I've dealt with in the past on basis, I'll give you the game. Without my opinion, I do my interviews, ask my questions, and without opinion. That's the thing where when you're on a beat roll, you have to maintain relationship with the team. You can't give your opinion. You have to kind of just keep it to what it is. Let the coach or player fill in the blanks, not you. Now, on this space, I can give my thoughts on what I saw. real thoughts and not have to
Yeah,
worry about.
you kind of get the best of both worlds, and I think I'm in a similar space, not exactly, but similar space where we get to give kind of that a lot more buttoned up version, and then you get a chance to have the kind of a little more uncut and freestyle, because the same on All Access, we own and get to have on who we want to have on and get to do it the way we want to do it. So I think there's some beauty in having both sides, and it also gives more credibility though too to us in these spaces to be able to say, hey, he also works for Atlanta Hawks. Hey, he also does broadcasting with ESPN and in the Mountain West and all those things. It just helps to build that credibility, which I think is important, and show, like you said, that range of I'm not just in this one box. You know, we can do more things than just this one.
Yeah, I've covered tennis. I've done golf. I did racing one time.
You're more versatile than me than that.
I did racing one time. I saw them Confederate flags in Hampton, Georgia at the Raceway in Atlanta.
Right. You're like, I'm out.
The Black Panther son in me came back. My dad's a Black Panther. I didn't tell you that. He's a Black Panther. So some of the Black
I'm
Panther
not
came out of me. So I ain't doing that. I've covered a bowling events in town, G League, the Dream, soccer. That's more of the international team in town, the Braves.
Right.
So I've done some range of sports. I've done political campaigns. That's interesting. I've done concerts, you know.
Yeah.
So having that range of what I've covered, so nobody can ever tell me, "Well, JR, you haven't covered this." I have. So now, why you don't want to let me in? You know. So
right.
I always say, so receipt, and also always anybody listening out here that's young media, always save your credentials, always save your email confirmations from events you cover. They come in handy down the road. Somebody wants to doubt who you are, doubt. Okay, well, look, I've covered this.
I think
So,
there's got to be a space for you now, though, too, though, where you feel like, and correct me if I'm wrong, everybody has a different kind of energy on this, but you know what you've accomplished. So you don't, even though you do have to prove to some people that don't know you, and I shouldn't say have to prove, you have to show them, or you choose to show them, like, hey, by the way, there's got to be a sense of accomplishment too, to know, like, not that I've arrived in this space, but I've made my place in this space. Is that fair to say?
I really never think that way. So I'm always having to fight. Like, it's always like the big events, US Open tennis tournament, the college football playoff. It's always a struggle and a fight. Cause like the Utah Jazz, so I'm gonna call him out. Mike Conley, somebody I know, friends with him, got mad because I had him on my show, and I didn't go through them. You didn't email me. You didn't answer my emails. So I texted the man who I knew personally from Memphis. So it's like people get mad when you go around them. But if you on the front end, you act right on the front end and actually don't, like, hey, blah blah blah, it wouldn't happen that way.
Right.
So for me, it's always about the fight. There's people like me who are in the independent Black media, independent media period, trying to get more content. How can you grow if you don't give them a chance to grow?
Right.
That's my thing. If you people want to grow, give them a chance to interview maybe a fifth the bench, a bench warmer. Give them a chance before they give them somebody bigger.
Right.
I go, yeah, like the Warriors let me talk to some people, and they, oh, JR's cool. We'll give him a higher guy more in the rotation. And I start off with bench warmers, G League guys, and they saw he does good work. At least give us a chance.
Right. Yeah, I think there's always a sense of a fight, though. So I guess there's a part where, yes, what you say makes perfect sense on one end, because you're always fighting for more. We're not satisfied or settled into, oh, I've just done this. But there is a sense of, even though we're fighting to get more and fighting to accomplish more and cover more and shine more light and do more of God's work, there's also the sense of, like, I'm here. You know what I mean? I'm here. You here. It's a fact. It's proven fact. The receipts speak for themselves. So if you're not going to celebrate it, which you do, but I'm going to celebrate it here. you're here. You have arrived. You're making waves in this space. You're going to continue to make more, but I want to make sure we celebrate that too, because it's too important, because it does look easy from the outside, and those that don't know how hard that fight is. But at the same time, as you're fighting, you have major space.
Yeah, I fight every day, brother, for Black media every day. Cause if you heard my phone beep there, I got an email from a team right now. You know, so like we all have to email him back and tell him like, nah, we ain't doing this. Saying is that nah, ain't happening. So go tell me. Like you know, he said something crazy just right now. So yeah, but that's every day, brothers. Every day it's a fight with these professional teams, college teams, every day. Like the U.S. Open, what have you covered?
But you have major space. And I think you said thank you. I don't know if I heard that. I think you did. Oh yeah, we celebrate.
Yeah, no doubt. Yeah, this space is a pure space, brothers. I call it a clean glass of water.
Yeah,
it's a purified space. There's no bias here, no narrative here. It's just we chatting, we having a real conversation. And brother, amen, before you go, I want to tell you this, man. I got 50 minutes to go before you got to get out of here. I appreciate you so much. I really do. And I mean that. Because you actually understand me, which is very rare for you to understand me for real. You actually understand me. So it's rare. But if you actually get me and understand what I'm about, and you see that I'm trying to make a difference out here in the world, and you know, for as intense as I can be on sidelines and things of that nature, I'm a pretty good guy. You know?
No doubt. We all have an intense side. No, I appreciate it. I'm just excited to be able to, again, this is my third time on, family of the show and family of yourself. And it's just happened very organically, to be honest. I actually, to give you kudos, I actually reached out to you, I think, one day. If I'm not mistaken, this
you
is
did.
How it started. I reached out, was interested. I think you had DJ Taylor on, somebody new, and I saw you had some head coaches on. I'm like, man, this brother's out here doing it. I've never seen this kind of thing. So I reached out. We hit it off from the jump and been riding on this wave ever since. And you've been nothing but supportive. And I think the part that is so cool is, you know, again, we've worked together as far as like helping with different contacts or different, you know, we're helping each other. It's not this crab in a bucket mentality. But I think the part I love is that you've created this space where people can kind of let their hair down and just be themselves, which a lot of times coaches and media don't really get to do that. And the better ones can put it on the show and kind of turn it on, but people kind of know that they can have a relaxed couch lounge type of vibe and still talk sports and still talk whatever. But I think you've created that amongst the coaching community, period. People that I've talked to, that I've connected you to, or that we've had a mutual contact and maybe this person told me about their experience. Yeah, I just think that's it should be celebrated, because that's important for coaches to be able to have that space. So salute you on that. Keep going. It only gets better.
No doubt, my brother. We'll do this again real soon, my guy, and be safe out there as it gets colder. And when I come to Denver, hopefully I catch you when I come to Denver, man. When we come out that way.
Yeah, let's do it. We'll make it happen.
No doubt.
You might have to wear your hoodie. You might have to wear your hoodie too. It might be cold.
I'll have one on, trust me, and some long johns underneath my brother. I don't do cold very well. Yes, indeed.
Well, appreciate it again, man.
No doubt, folks. It's Brian Burton, Uprise Athletics, All Access Network, Rising Coaches. He does a lot of stuff, broadcast, ESPN. Check him out. Coach Burton 313 on Twitter, Instagram, all that good stuff. Folks, JR, Brian Burton. We out.